Good morning. A few announcements before we begin worship. It's an exciting day. We are bringing in three students, Peter, Will, and Seth this morning. It'll be in the last third of the worship service, and so we're excited about that. The confirmation class or affirmation of faith class was a wild one in the sense not of their behavior, but we started it, then had to stop. We started it, and COVID came, and we moved to Zoom, and now we get to bring them in. And so it's exciting. They met with the elders this morning prior to the service. We will be trying to have our Advent wreath and Advent candles all season long, and the Nasto family will be lighting that. They don't come up yet, but so that'll still be a part. As we look, we'll continue to try to have in-person worship service. We're currently looking at Christmas Eve and what we're going to do with that. You know, the numbers are rising. I know within the Ridgewood school system, several of their schools have gone to remote only. So we see and we just monitor that as we go. We'll continue to email and do the one call, tell all, so everyone will be in the loop and hopefully know what will happen. And so this week, the consistory will look and begin to think about Christmas Eve and how we're going to navigate that time. Hopefully, you were emailed the Spire, and so that has gone out for this month. We are looking to have a Zoom Christmas party this year. All that information's in there, and email is also going to go out. So we will still try to stay connected through Zoom. So take a look at that. Mark that on your calendar, and soon I'll be sending out a link to that Zoom Christmas party. A little bit different. And also, there is still time. We're collecting hymns or Christmas carols for Advent and for Christmas. If you have a suggestion, email me or call the office and leave it with Kathy, and we'll put those in together. The selections today are from people who have suggested them. So that's just a fun part of being active in the service, even during this kind of different time. And one last announcement. Jim, Albie's mother, has turned 100 years old today. Mary Fenner Albies. And the flowers are in her honor, which is pretty amazing. 100 years. What a celebration. Those are our announcements. We'll now begin worship with our prelude.
Thank you.
this time, I'd like to call the Nasto family forward for the Advent lighting. We wait for the song. O God, we light the first candle of Advent.
We kindle it with hope. We long for you to come to our world, to break through the coldness and reign with compassion, justice, and peace.
The prophet Isaiah also cried to God to tear open heaven and come down. He called God's people to do right. Isaiah called them to be refashioned like clay by God, the potter. This Advent, we call out to God.
Mighty God, creator of the world, break through all that keeps us from you. We ask for your mercy and reform us in your image. This Advent, visit us with your justice, love, and peace. Amen.
Thank you, Nastas. Our first Christmas carol this season was suggested by Susan Robertson, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel, hymn number 9. Our soloists will sing. We're still not singing as a congregation yet. And what verses are we singing? All three. So all three verses.
All peoples in one heart and mind.
As we prepare and approach to hear God's word, we know that if we confess our sins, we will find forgiveness through our Lord Jesus. So this morning I'll be leading us through our prayer of confession. Let us pray. Sovereign God, we confess that we are not ready for your holy realm. You guide us toward right paths, but we refuse to follow where you lead. You love and feed and care for us, but we fail to love and serve others. Forgive us, merciful God, so that we may return to your fold and rejoice in your presence. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the Lamb upon the throne. Amen. The good news of Advent is that Jesus Christ has come into the world, has led the way through death that we may have life, and is coming again to make all things new. Hear these words of assurance from Romans 5. God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? Amen. And now hear what our Lord says about the law. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen. Our scripture passage, our first is our Old Testament lesson from Isaiah chapter 64, and then our gospel lesson is found in Mark 13. Let us pray as we prepare our hearts and minds to hear God's word. Shine your light on your word, O Lord. By your Spirit, let us see your wonder. For your justice outruns our sense of fairness. Your love overwhelms our deepest affections. Open our eyes, unstop our ears, and show us your most excellent way for Jesus' sake. Amen. Our Old Testament lesson, Isaiah chapter 64, verses 1 through 9. Hear God's word. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence. As when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf. And our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you. Or you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay and you are the potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are your people. And now our gospel lesson, Mark 13, verses 24 through 34. But in those days after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know the summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows. Neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come in the evening, or at midnight, or at the cock crow, or at dawn. Or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. We're in the season of Advent, and Christmas is coming, and it's been a crazy year, so we are longing for that sense of joy and that sense of wonder that we get with Christmas. Advent is a certain season. It's a time of waiting and longing. And we can often wonder, what is Advent all about? Well, this last week I was pondering and thinking, and I realized that in my life as a human being, there has been at least a few occasions in my life, especially when I was growing up, that I made big enough mistakes that I really needed my parents to rescue me and to bail me out. And as I think of those moments, I realize that in those hard times, I both wanted my parents to come and I also wanted them not to come. In fact, I'll share one of the easier ones with you, even though you might be like, oh, what a trouble that kid was, and that's probably the truth. But when I was growing up, I was still in grade school, I was probably fifth or sixth grade, and my brother Brian and I and a friend of ours were just out playing in the neighborhood. And not far from our house was what we call the city garage, with all the city vehicles. And this was a small town. Nothing was locked up. I bet you the keys were actually in each of the vehicles. And we were out by the river playing and adventuring cops and robbers and all those things. And we get into where all the trucks and cars are, and we start climbing and playing in them. Nothing, I think, too wrong or too bad. Well, my friend, I'm not going to mention his name, he discovered a fire extinguisher in the truck. They're pretty fun to shoot off if you've ever shot off a fire extinguisher. And so he was shooting off the fire extinguisher. We found some other ones. We shot them off too and thought it was a fun time until, of course, the people who worked there started chasing us. I happened to be the fastest, apparently, and I was long gone through the lot. My brother and friend were caught and they called me back. The police came. We rode in the police car to the police station in the back. Whole time, dreading. My friend, he was from a large Italian family, the youngest of five. He thought he was dead. He saw what his dad did to his two older brothers. I think he pleaded with the guy, just lock me up. Don't call him. We get there and we're sitting on the bench in the police station. They call our parents, and we're dreading and also wanting them to come and rescue. So that was really the advent of our parents. That's what Advent is. It's waiting, expecting their arrival. Fear and trepidation and guilt and not knowing what was going to happen. Because, you know, we did something wrong. We also know our parents love us. You're just wrestling in that. I imagine everyone here was a better kid than me. But in life, are there those moments when you've made such a mistake, You long for a rescue, often if you're younger, from your parents. But also the guilt and the shame makes you not want them. Well, I'm the youngest of three boys, as I've said, and my friend was the youngest. And he found out, you know, the older kids will say, being the youngest is a charmed life. He didn't get in much trouble. His dad was really good to him. So he was like, "Woo, we got in trouble, you know, grounded and things like that." But the situation was fixed because our parents come and things are dealt with. This is part of Advent, and our Isaiah passage is really just like that. The Israelites in Isaiah, who is speaking on God's behalf and their behalf, is pleading with God to come back. Come back. You've been vacant from us. We know we have gone astray. And in that longing and in that calling for God, there is both the expectation of a gracious God and wanting that to happen, but also with fear and trepidation, not knowing exactly. And that pleading really starts, if you didn't notice, those first few verses is really what the Exodus story was all about, right? God surprised them, redeemed them, brought them through the desert, and with the Ten Commandments and God's revealing to them, it was the earth and the mountain quaking. And so they rest in the fact that in the past, God has redeemed them and has been good to them, and they want to rest in that. Then they say, you know, we haven't been completely bad. You know, you like the people who are righteous. We have been righteous in the past. And then they confess, but we have sinned and we have gone astray. Walter Brueggemann reminds us that in his Old Testament theology book, that in the Old Testament, they had a view of God in this covenant relationship, that God and God's people would be together, and that they would keep covenant, and the people would keep the commandments, and that the people knew that God was good and wonderful, but that God also didn't like sin and wrongdoing and wanted them to be righteous. And so when they call and want God to come back, they have both those things kind of weighing on them. God's love, God's care, but also God's thirst for righteousness and justice. And so that's part of the turmoil. And so we see that beautifully, I think, in Isaiah. But then this beautiful image that they're resting in that goes to really more of the grace and more of the care. They say, God, you are our Father. We are like clay and you are the potter. And so the plea is, God, we know we are broken, but just don't throw us out. Don't break us, but repair us and come back. And in that, there is a line, I hope you didn't miss it, that they feel that God is not present in their lives. How often in your life have you felt a loneliness and wondered if God was even present? That's what they're wrestling with. That's what they're feeling. And they want God's presence to be felt in a more real way. And they long for that restoration. They long for a creator who loves and cares for them and restores them to newness. That is what Advent is all about. We long for God's presence to be felt in a new and more powerful way, and we long for restoration. And the Gospel of Mark reminds us that we're not going to know when Jesus will come again. And the tension there is that we won't know, so don't try to guess, but be prepared for it to happen at any moment. So we long for that restoration. We long for renewal. We long for God's presence in a new way. And we know that has been promised to us, that as in Advent we wait, we can feel God's presence. And we also know that Christ will come again, and this world will be made whole once again. That's a beautiful image of Advent. And in it, wherever you're at in life, I hope that you'll feel God's presence in a new way and God's restoration and renewal in a new way. Amen. I'm very excited to have our affirmation of faith class, and I'm going to call our students up at this time. You guys want to come on up? You guys know I love baptisms. I also love affirmation of faith, where our students in that baptismal promise are now making and affirming the faith that God has gifted them with. And today is special. I've been your pastor for 7 years. We have students that you really have seen grow up in this church. And I know we can all remember when they were much smaller, maybe even a little cuter. But now they come in and they get to be members of our church. So it's good news. Hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. Hear also these words from Holy Scripture. For the promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to him. Baptism is the sign and seal of God's promises to this covenant people. In baptism, God promises by grace alone to forgive sins, to adopt us into the body of Christ the church, and to send the Holy Spirit daily to renew and cleanse us, and to resurrect us to eternal life. This promise is made visible in the water of baptism. Water cleanses, purifies, refreshes, sustains. Jesus Christ is the living water.
The elders of Old Paramus Reformed Church have welcomed these young men who appeared before them and made profession of their faith. Peter, Seth, and Will have been baptized into the body of Christ in making public this profession of faith. They affirm their meaning of their baptism. We ask them now to declare the faith before God and Christ's church, that we may rejoice together and welcome them as brothers in Christ.
Beloved of God, I ask you before God and Christ's church to reject evil, to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, and to confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce sin and the power of evil in your life and in the world? Who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Will you be a faithful member of this congregation and through worship and service seek to advance God's purposes here and throughout the world?
I will. I ask God to help me.
To the congregation.
And you guys need to stand.
Do you promise to love and encourage and support these brothers by teaching the gospel of God's love, by being an example of Christian faith and character, and by giving the strong support of God's family in fellowship, prayer, and service?
If you agree, you say, we do, right? We do. All right. You guys can stay standing for the Apostles' Creed in a moment. Last question for you guys. Do you promise to accept the spiritual guidance of the church, to walk in a spirit of Christian love with this congregation, and to seek those things that make for unity, purity, and peace?
Shall we now recite the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty.
From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
And now a welcome and a blessing. Defend, O Lord, these your servants, Will, Seth, and Peter, with your heavenly grace, that they may continue yours forever, and daily increase your spirit more and more until they come to your eternal kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By the Holy Spirit, all who believe and are baptized receive a ministry to witness to Jesus as Savior and Lord, and to love and serve those with whom they live and work. We are ambassadors for Christ, who reconciles and makes us whole. We are salt of the earth, we are the light of the world. And now we welcome our brothers in Christ, William Beckman, Seth Miller, and Peter Nasto. And we do that with an applause. That's how we... And now a blessing for all of us. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Congratulations. Normally I shake hands. We'll just go like that. You guys can have a seat. An exciting day. As we respond to God's word, we now have our second Christmas carol, the First Noel, which was suggested by Claudia Obowski and also Susan Robertson. And so we'll have the first two verses, and then we'll have our prayer of intercession and the Lord's Prayer, and then we'll conclude with the third and fourth verse. It is in our joyful duty that we should at all times and at all places give thanks to thee, O Holy Lord, Father Almighty, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For he has redeemed us from death and destruction, and on this day did rise glorious from the dead, and has given us the blessed hope of everlasting life. O God, in glory exalted and in mercy ever blessed, we magnify thee, we praise thee, we give thanks to thee for all thy bountiful providence, for all the blessings of this present life, and for the hope of a better life yet to come. Let the memory of thy goodness fill our hearts with joy and thankfulness, and let no unworthiness of ours provoke thee to withhold from us any needed good. Seeing that all our blessings come not by our by our strength, but only through the merit and mediation of Jesus Christ our Lord. Almighty God, who has taught us to make intercession for all people, we pray not only for ourselves here present, but for all thy children of every nation, tribe, and tongue. We pray for all who are without the blessed light of the gospel. May it please thee to speed thy church in its mission to make thy truth known to all your children, thy saving health to all nations. Give strength to all who are engaged in the ministry of preaching, teaching, and healing. We pray for thy church of every name and every right, the whole family of thy people who worship thee in spirit and in truth. May all thy ministers and people be found faithful in life and doctrine, and by them may all who have wandered and gone astray be brought safely back to the fold. Direct and govern, we pray, all who are engaged in the tasks of government. We pray for thy blessing on the servant, the President of the United States, and all others to whom people have entrusted power and authority. Let thy fatherly favor so preserve them that true religion may be preserved in our land, and the people abide in righteousness and peace. Finally, we offer to thee in the silence of our hearts our petitions for those near and dear to us and for all who are in need of our prayers. Be with them and help them, we pray. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with the Father and the Holy Spirit be all glory, dominion, and power, world without end, now as our Savior has taught us, we humbly pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. God's blessing. May the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you today and the days to follow. Amen.